Thank you so much, James Simon. That was wonderful. Well, next, we have Sharon Parish, and then we'll follow that with Shannon Chavez, and then we'll bring everyone up for a brief Q&A before we have to leave around 2 o'clock or so. Sharon?
Before I go into my talk, I just want to say a word about ISWISH, which, of course, Cheryl spoke about, and we showed you the video we made at our last meeting. So ISWISH is the International Society for the Study of Women's Sexual Health, and we have a mission of promoting education for healthcare providers across numerous disciplines, and we have a very multidisciplinary society. All of our panel members are either ISWISH members, board members, officers, past president. We are fully invested in multidisciplinary work, both providing clinical care and talking about clinical interventions, basic science research, clinical research, professional education, and now we're expanding to patient advocacy and running a patient course at our next annual meeting. And we are happy to talk to anybody who would like to hear more about ISWISH. It's a wonderful society, and it's the only society in the world strictly dedicated to the study, care, and treatment and research of for patients and providers and so forth related to women's sexual health. So please ask us more about it. And I do also get very emotional every time I see the video. It's really quite moving. All of the people in the video were members of or attendees at the meeting, and they feel as strongly as they look in the video about promoting women's sexual health worldwide. So my topic is sexuality and quality of life. And I'm going to reiterate some of the points that were made, but I think I'm really going to focus on my purpose is to focus on quality of life. And I'm going to show data to emphasize the point, but really want to drive home some of the key take-home messages of the data that it represents. So I'm going to be a little more clinical here and talk about one of my patients. So this is a postmenopausal patient. That is not her picture, but it's her capturing the feeling that she conveyed to me. She's 63, she's married, and she has, as Cheryl described, multidimensional FSD, like the Venn diagram shows. She had the onset of sudden loss of desire, and that she meant that by libido or sex drive, the drive to have sex, corresponding to her perimenopausal symptoms. She reported at the time of the visit low initiation and frequency, agreeing to intercourse every 1 to 2 months to please her partner and build intimacy with him. She was experiencing dyspareunia, that's pain with intercourse, primarily introital. She had arousal problems, that is lubrication and subjective arousal, difficulty reaching orgasm, and certainly a diminished orgasm quality when she was able to. She had other medical problems, as many of my patients do. I'm an internist. I'm a medical internist. I work in New York. She had hypertension, hyperlipidemia. She had long-standing depression, and she was controlled in her depression by a serotonin reuptake inhibitor. That's an antidepressant therapy. And she had still significant insomnia despite her improved mood. And the insomnia had sort of kicked in around menopause and related to its symptoms and really never abated, despite long-standing treated depression. Her pelvic exam showed some of the features that you saw in the slides in Dr. Simon's talk, but it was moderate, not the kind that has to go to the OR, thank God. I didn't know you had to do that, but not that bad. But she had not been on treatment. She had been having sex probably about, as I said, once every 1 to 2 months, so not so much the use it or lose it kind. And she did have a low testosterone, and Cheryl mentioned that as a possible option for therapy. She was referred to me by her husband's physician, who's a prostate cancer specialist in New York at Memorial Sloan Kettering. And he'd been on, as part of his cancer treatment, he's on a year at least of daily PDE5 inhibitor therapy. So hence, the referral was triggered. I'm stuck too here. Okay. So since menopause, just a little more about this patient and how it relates to what you already heard as we talk about quality of life. Progressive vaginal dryness and tightness with intercourse and penetration, little spontaneous or responsive desire, like not even sort of like getting going when she started. She did try to plan, though, as many women do, to try to make it go forward, thinking about what she used to wear or what they used to do, anything to get it going, but it wasn't working. And I talked about arousal. And women, I think it's important that to understand that women kind of have two things going with arousal. It's what they feel in their genitals and whether they get a sensation and whether they lubricate. Arousal and lubrication may not be synonymous, and they aren't the same thing for women. And also that feeling of being turned on. And that it's not clear with the new definition if we want to call that desire, arousal, or both, but she reported problems with both. Although they had foreplay and some kissing and touching, it wasn't robust, and they sort of had given up. And lubricants, the first pass at lubricants were not very helpful. I found she and many of my patients are poorly educated about their options, in other words, the three types. And also, sometimes things are irritating to the dry, tight, thin mucosa of the postmenopausal female. And they need to know that they want to avoid things that are have colors and flavors and additives. And there's advice we can give them that's very specific. And there are helpful websites, which Dr. Chavez may go into. The important thing is that the satisfaction was low. And what goes into satisfaction is complex. So with this patient, I'm making the point about our patients and their quality of life and why they seek sexual medical care for me and other providers. The marriage is important to them, and usually the marriages are good in many of the patients that I see. In this case, she suddenly thought, you know what, why don't I ever initiate sex? I have that distortion of my perspective that Cheryl talked about, which I can't remember the name of. But I want to make it a priority. I want to be an initiator. For some reason, it was time, the third phase of her life. Intimacy was important to her, and she was feeling receptive to advice that I had. But most importantly, the partner with his new had a new interest because of his new drug, and he was willing to help, but this was a big motivator, and you see this over and over. So this is comes from an old study that Ed Laumann published in 1999, looking at the relationship, this is an association, of female sexual dysfunction to well-being. So women report low physical satisfaction, low emotional satisfaction, and low overall happiness. And you can see arousal disorder is the highest bar. And that was a study of women of all ages, 18 to 59, and postmenopausal women were not separated, but I suspect they were a big contributor to the results. What do we know about menopause? So Lorraine Dennerstein's done a lot of research on this, looking at the complexity of this. And the most important factor affecting sexual response in her data was the partner. Change in the partner, the status of the partner, the feelings toward the partner, whether there was a partner. And the most important, in all the research, the most important medical factor is probably estradiol and what we've been discussing. In Dr. Dennerstein's research, there are some social factors that do ameliorate the overall decline after menopause in just sexual function as a general concept. And those include things like your past history, your health, your marriage, your relationship, education, social class, and your attitude. This doesn't compensate for everything, but it can be a big contributor. So when I look at patients, I think about these factors. Two other studies I'd like to mention because I think they're interesting. One talks about midlife women, and those in this particular study with a higher sense of purpose reported more sexual enjoyment. Another study talks about women who felt satisfied with the emotional closeness of the relationship were more likely to report a better sexual response. So these are interesting pieces to how women perceive their sexuality. I'm going to now transition into a collection of surveys, and I'm using them to illustrate some points in more detail about some of the issues we've been discussing and to discuss quality of life issues in more depth. So since 2006, 6+ surveys have been published on women's views of the impact of menopause and vulvovaginal atrophy on their sexual health. I'm going to talk about Reveal, Revealing Vaginal Effects of Life, Viva, Vaginal Health Insights, Views, and Attitudes. And there are both European and U.S. data that have been published. The Closer study, which is clarifying vaginal atrophy's impact on sex and relationships. Revive, Real Women's View of Treatment Options for Menopausal, Vulvar, and Vaginal Changes. Women's Voices in the Menopause, and a survey called Healthy Women. They show these surveys as a group, the negative impact of vulvovaginal atrophy on sexual health, and describe numerous and substantial barriers to treatment, both on the patient and the provider end. And they also tell us interesting things about the partner. Several of us here speaking were co-authors on a review of these surveys and the references on the slides. All of the other references are listed in that tiny print, and I'm happy to provide them to you if you have more interest in knowing and reading about them in more detail. So first, this comes from Reveal, and it's not important for you to remember which of those six surveys I took them from. I'm just kind of reporting the robustness of the research, and I'll quote the survey just to be precise, but I'm going to really focus on the point of what I'm trying to make with the selected survey for each point. So here I want to talk about patient awareness of menopausal symptoms. So in the Reveal study, patients were asked, which have you heard of women experiencing? Which have you experienced regarding menopause? And women were quite familiar with the hot flashes, the night sweats, the mood swings, over 90 and upwards percent. But they were less familiar or aware with physical discomfort inside the vagina during sexual activity and the fact that there were changes in the urogenital symptoms, difficulty reaching orgasm, urinary tract infections, and so forth. And although they may be having symptoms, they weren't connecting them to menopause or the changes in their hormones or otherwise related to menopause, which has implications for receptivity to advice or treatment. In the Reveal study, some interesting things about vulvovaginal atrophy and dyspareunia and women's behavior. So about half of the women had dryness, itching, burning, and they really said they kind of learned to live with this as part of aging, but not necessarily thinking about it as part of menopause where there's a change that may be addressed potentially with some medical interventions or even non-pharmacologic interventions that require advice. About a quarter, and these women were on the younger side of postmenopausal, peri and postmenopausal, about a quarter really had true pain, while more had dryness and so forth. But interestingly, 36% of those with pain said that that pain required some change in what they did regarding their sexual activity. And in fact, I'm sorry, this is a sticky turn thing here. Despite that, at least three quarters of them did go forward and have sex despite the pain. So women are soldiering on despite being in pain, and this is important. This has also been discussed in the Healthy Woman survey. The majority of the sufferers in this survey really talked about not wanting to have sex because of their discomfort. And the majority or most of those who experienced painful intercourse indicated that they still did have sex, just like I showed you in the Reveal study, up to once a week. And they did it for their partner because they cared about the relationship. We hear that over and over. What about, and you heard a little bit of data already, but let's elaborate further. What about the association of genital, urogenital, and vaginal changes after menopause with female sexual dysfunction? And there's no proof of cause and effect. These are associations, so they're bidirectional. So in one trial, this is more about behavior, but patients hid the symptoms from their partner. They did avoidance instead of talking about it. In the Levine study, which you heard a bit about, about over half or the majority had symptoms, and about half had female sexual dysfunction and usually multidimensional, not just dyspareunia. There's resultant or concomitant other female sexual dysfunctions. Women with female sexual dysfunction were more likely to have vulvovaginal atrophy. Again, this is an association. Some things modified the effect. So hot flashes seemed to have a bigger impact than VVA on desire. Education seemed to improve arousal problems, like I showed you in that earlier slide about the effect of menopause. And parity modified the association with orgasmic difficulty in a negative direction, actually. And that may have to do with other anatomic changes. In another study by the author on the top, women really endorsed that dryness did have had a forward-feeding effect on libido. It was dry, it was painful, therefore they didn't want to. But separating concomitants and direction is a little difficult in this research. And women are distressed. They don't like their sex drive going down, and they don't like pain, and they don't like having to make these changes in their sexual behavior. As far as what symptoms are actually most bothersome, in the Revive study, here, the painful sex, the bleeding with sex, was more bothersome than some of the other things that they reported, like pain with exercise, tenderness, and so forth. I don't like pain. This is a little complicated to look at, but what this talks about is the impact on the sex life versus the impact on other aspects of women's lives when they experience vulvovaginal atrophy. So in the The yellow are people with no partner. The middle line going across the chart are people in general, and the pink are those with a partner. And you can see if you look at the left side of the chart, VVA impacted things in a smaller percentage of women, but actually, interestingly, more in the no partner group. Life things like traveling, athletic activities, and so forth, social activities. But if you look at the partnered women, a much more substantial number of women who had partners compared to women with no partners talked about things, as it kind of makes sense, things like enjoyment, spontaneity, being intimate, having a relationship with partner, and so forth. And again, this just helps you look at the differences if you look at the coloration here. I think we're stuck again here. Sorry. There we go. Thanks. Okay. I'm going to move on to some more specific data on impact and quality of life. And this comes from one of the trials called the VIVA trial. And it's a combination of European and U.S. data. The U.S. data was most recently published. So women feel less sexual when they have vaginal discomfort. They describe impact on, most importantly, on intimacy, as I've already shown you. That was a different study, but now I'm showing you. These numbers are even more robust than what you just saw in a different study, the graph that I just showed you. So consequences on sex life, marriage, feeling old, self-esteem, and so forth. These are very general feelings, and they don't just limit, they aren't just about internalized feelings that aren't just limited to the actual act of sex. I'm going to now talk about the implications for couples, and I'm going to move on to something called the Closer trial. I don't have a slide on this, but I would like to mention the females trial, which I thought was a very interesting trial. It looked at, this was a study looking at the female partners of men who had been treated for erectile dysfunction with a PDE5 inhibitor, and it followed another trial called the males trial, and the males trial really looked at the impact on quality of life of treatment for ED with PDE5 inhibitors, and that trial, obviously, quality of life parameters improved when men were treated. So the females trial looked at how women's sexual function improved when their male partners were treated, and interestingly, many parameters and quality of life improved. But there had never been, up to the Closer trial, a real look at the impact of treatment on partners when women were treated after menopause for postmenopausal vaginal symptoms. So that's what the Closer trial looks at. And here we see that women weren't necessarily telling their partner about the pain, and that is sort of suggested by the other data about how women were avoiding sex and not engaging in sex. But when the men were asked, they really wanted their partner, more the majority of men wanted their partner to talk to them about it. They wanted to hear about it. And the couple together talked about some of the things that you've seen already echoed in the patient surveys, the women's surveys. Women had lower desire, the sex and intimacy were issues, and both agreed, the men and the women, that when they specifically were treated at the time of this study, we had only local estrogen available as opposed to some of the oral options now. They said the treatment did improve their sex life. So people were enthusiastic about treatment, but they wanted safe options, and they had issues about concerns about adverse effects and safety, which is really an important piece of education. So this is a little more detail about the Closer trial. It's a little hard to see the things on the bottom, but I think the important thing is to look at how well matched the responses were. So the gray are women and the black bars are men. And you can see they were in agreement that intimacy was being avoided because of vaginal discomfort. Libido was lost. Sex was painful. They were both worried, and they were very well matched here, that sex would be painful. They worried about satisfaction, about satisfying each other, and both of them felt less attractive. So it had an effect on both of them when the woman had pain during sexual activity. So they're in sync, but they're not necessarily communicating or talking to each other and coming up with constructive or paired solutions, and I hope Dr. Chavez will address that. Okay, I'd like to just take a couple more minutes on the surveys and transition to the last part of this, which is patient barriers. So patients in some of these surveys really talked about barriers. They were internal barriers, and they were barriers in the healthcare system as to why they weren't getting treatment. This comes from the REVEAL study, but it echoes what you see in some of the other studies, that patients were embarrassed. They didn't think there were medical treatments. They felt poorly educated about their options. They didn't know if it was appropriate, and they weren't sure how the healthcare provider, what the healthcare provider knew, or whether how the healthcare provider would respond. In Women's Voices, the majority really hadn't spoken to their healthcare provider. They really just had not. And they just didn't think they were comfortable. Mostly they were embarrassed. Women hadn't even talked to anyone else either. They thought it was private. They thought, people don't want to hear about my vagina. They weren't talking to friends, other women, other advisors. It was just difficult to get information. Patients in not just with dyspareunia, vulvovaginal atrophy, but with all sexual dysfunctions, men and women prefer the healthcare provider to really initiate the conversation. And this is something that we teach in all of our courses. We teach that healthcare providers need to screen and ask and normalize and universalize the inquiry for a given group. And I'm sure we'll go into this more when we talk about communication. The women in Reveal really emphasize the societal constraints and their perspective on society's view of women's sexuality. And I'll make a few concluding points about the surveys with this slide. So women really endorse that society constrained the sexual expression of women my age much more than men, that society was much more accepting of discussing men's physical sexual problems than women's sexual problems, and they really felt that there were medicines for men, but the same weren't true for women, and that upset them. And women really just felt like society didn't want me to talk about my vagina. That was over and over and over. Okay, I'm going to spend the last, and I just want to conclude with this slide regarding this section. You've already heard a lot about estrogen. Both oral and topical therapy improve symptoms. And we don't have data yet on the oral therapy's impact on quality of life. But it, for example, in the Women Voices study, the majority of women said that when they got treatment, it improved their sexual and overall quality of life. So I think we need more information about improvements in quality of life as the other treatments are available in the market for a longer period of time. Okay. I'm going to transition to one last piece here in my last few minutes. And if you remember back, my patient had depression, right? And depression is a really big factor for women. And there's a lot of confusion about whether we should treat depression and whether antidepressants and their, you know, and so forth are a good or bad thing for sexuality. So Cheryl Kingsburg showed you earlier in the day this trial, the PRESIDE trial. And the purpose of showing you this slide is to look at this last column. This shows you, if you take out the effect of depression, you take out a little less than half of the total impact. So in other words, depression has nearly half of the impact on all the sexual dysfunctions. It's a big factor as to why, or a comorbidity or factor as to why women experience sexual dysfunction. There's a bidirectional association between depression and sexual dysfunction. So in one analysis, depression increased the risk of sexual dysfunction, and sexual dysfunction increased the odds of depression. So it's bidirectional, and we need to address both simultaneously. This looks at the relative impact of depression as compared to all other medical problems on sexual distress. And you can see that depression it was sort of a weighted impact, has a much stronger impact on all phases, desire, arousal, orgasm, or any, as compared to some of the common medical problems that are strongly and frequently associated with sexual dysfunction. Depression has a strong psychosocial impact, both on women and on their sexuality and on their relationships. So depressed women are more likely to be unhappy with their partner relationships, have trouble forming and maintaining relationships, have a lower frequency of sex with their partners than women without depression. They're more likely to binge drink and screen positive for alcohol and substance abuse, even prescription substance abuse, which is a highly underdiagnosed issue and underdiscussed issue with regard to sexual function and relationship function. There's a lot of comorbidities. And there's likely to be this interaction between the two due to the relationship of the overlap of neurotransmitter and neuroendocrine systems affected, which means something for the need for treatments and to really look with scrutiny at how the treatments for depression affect sexual dysfunction, how the treatments for sexual dysfunction affect mood, and what is the overlap in the treatment efficacy and the comorbidities and how we can impact them by doing more research on available and potentially providing available treatments for women. And I think this is an important piece in advocacy. SSRI-induced sexual dysfunction, I'll just sort of end with this point. SSRIs, which are the most commonly prescribed drug in America for women, it's not estrogen therapy, it's not antihypertensive therapy, it's not lipid-lowering therapy, it's antidepressants. This is the most commonly prescribed drug for women of all ages in the United States. And they're prescribed for depression, They're prescribed for hot flashes. They're prescribed for anxiety. They're prescribed for pain. They're prescribed for sleep. This is a very commonly used drug. So what is the effect on sexual function? This group of drugs diminishes libido, and the mechanism is listed. Arousal, due to the local effects on nitric oxide. It affects orgasm up to over 60%. It causes orgasmic delay or anorgasmia. And these sexual side effects lead to noncompliance, discontinuation, and decreased recovery. And physicians were particularly studied. Their perceptions are that this doesn't affect their patients. And this presents a dilemma because depression is a bad problem. And you just saw the data I showed you about the impact of depression on women overall. So there is good news. This comes from an analysis done by Ray Rosen and Anita Clayton, and it looks at the correlates of distress in women with low sexual desire particularly. And they found that while depressed women were worse than non-depressed women, women who were treated with medications seemed to do better overall. And there's an array of data sort of looking at how to choose the drug and how to think wisely about drug substitution or drug combining when thinking about the correct choice of antidepressant therapy in women. And there's no data, and I would love to collaborate on a study with anyone looking at the comparison of good psychotherapy and cognitive behavioral therapy compared to antidepressant therapy and its impact in those treatment arms on sexual function in women. The important thing is to get a woman undepressed. I think the thing you're seeing here is that when you get her undepressed, she does better than if she's depressed, even if her drug may present a problem. And so this is a really important piece for any women of any age, and particularly for postmenopausal women, as they're being treated with these medications for other comorbidities. So in conclusion, female sexual dysfunction affects over 50% of postmenopausal women. Female sexual dysfunction is often multidimensional, and it impacts women's lives and their relationships across numerous domains. Social factors play an important role in the perceived impact. Societal views, lack of awareness, and barriers to treatment and care do impede effective management, and this is a call to action. Thank you very much for your attention, and I look forward to the questions.